Excellent. So the time is 10:10 just now. And today we have a guest lecture, Jessie Kendall Barr. She is a graduate student at UC Santa Cruz and a Cal alumni. And she's going to tell us all about marine animals today. And I believe she'll also tell us a bit about her research that she's doing for her dissertation. And I will let Jess take it away. Feel free to ask questions in the chat. Jess, I may interrupt you, or Jesse, rather, sorry. I may interrupt you if there's questions filing in and you're on a roll. So.
Okay. Yeah, for some reason I'm not able to get the chat up on my screen. So I would appreciate that. Awesome. Okay, I'm going to use this. Hello, my name is Jessie Kendall Barr. I graduated from Berkeley in December of 2016, where I majored in marine science and integrative biology. I went on three different research cruises with Professor Jim Bishop. And I worked on this course for about 4 years during my undergrad, first as a curriculum developer and then as a GSI. While at Berkeley, I did research on octopus mating and behavior in the Caldwell Lab. I looked at den fidelity and behavior of moray eels on Moorea in French Polynesia during the IB 158 field course. I studied mating and sexual selection in arthropods at Friday Harbor Labs in Washington. And did a project looking at the distribution and behavior of pilot whales in the eastern tropical Pacific at the NOAA Southwest Fisheries Science Center in San Diego. And then finally, I did a sleep study on fur seals and beluga whales in the in Russia in the summer of 2016. And right now, I'm in my 4th year of a PhD program at UC Santa Cruz, where I'm studying the sleep patterns of elephant seals in the wild. So I basically create devices that go on the heads of seals to measure their brain activity while they're sleeping. And it's the first non-invasive recording of sleep in marine mammals. And this year we did the first recording of marine mammal sleep in the wild. That's Snoozy Susie, the super wiener pictured right here. She's called a super wiener because she nursed from two different moms and got a full 2 doses of milk. She was 200 kilograms, which is about 400 pounds at the time that we recorded her, and only 75 days old. So pretty chunky. So yeah, I've dabbled in a lot of very different fields within marine biology, and I would be very happy to talk to anyone about pursuing marine biology here at Berkeley or just in general. So I put my email and website up here in case you want to ask me anything. Today, I'm going to show you just a sliver of the huge amount of diversity there is in the animal kingdom. So I'll go over each of the major groups of animals, or phyla, as well as a couple common animals in each group. So along with research, I love to do underwater photography. So a lot of the pictures that you'll see here are ones that I've taken. So if I've taken the picture, there'll be a little black number like you see right here. And there's a key at the end of these slides that tell you what animal it is and where the picture was taken. So this tree shows the evolutionary relationships between all the marine phyla that we'll be talking about today. So you've already learned about some single-celled animals, but now we'll move into more complex multicellular animals. At some point, almost 1 billion years ago, some colonial protists evolved true tissues and others didn't. The ones that didn't evolved into our modern-day sponges, which make up a group called Porifera, which means pore bearing. The ones with true tissues are called eumetazoans or metazoans, and those have true tissues. True tissues are basically cells that all work together, that share a common structure and a common function. The common ancestor of all metazoans then gave rise to two lineages, which are defined by their symmetry. So one of those lineages has radial symmetry, or a symmetry about a point like a circle or a wheel, and this lineage gave rise to our modern-day cnidarians. The rest of the animals evolved bilateral symmetry, which means that they're symmetrical about an axis so that their right sides match their left sides. Bilaterians then split to give rise to protostomes and deuterostomes. This distinction refers to the order in which development occurs. So in protostomes, the mouth forms first. Stoma means mouth and proto means first. The other group, the deuterostomes, have a development which begins with the anus and has the mouth develop second. Deutero means second. The protostomes include two groups. We have the lophotrochozoans, it's quite a mouthful, which all share a larval stage called a trochophore or a feeding appendage called the lophophore. Those include a lot of groups, but the two that we'll talk about today are mollusks and annelids. And the other group are the ecdysozoans, which are all invertebrates which undergo ecdysis, which is the process of molting. These include arthropods as well as nematodes, but we'll just talk about arthropods today. The deuterostomes include two phyla, Echinodermata, which include sea stars and sea cucumbers, and Chordata, which is the phylum that we're a part of. So we're going to move from left to right across the tree, starting with peripherans. So periphera, literally meaning pore-bearing, because they have tons of holes. They're sponges. As you can see, they're very easily surprised. Sponges don't have true tissues. These animals don't have a digestive or circulatory system, so they get nutrients through simple diffusion at their cellular level. And they exchange gases needed for cellular metabolism using simple diffusion. They are suspension feeders, which means that they eat suspended particles in the water as they filter it through their tissues. Structurally, they're made up of either glass, spongin, or calcium carbonate. So I'm gonna see if my videos will work. Sometimes I have to flip the slide a couple times. So this shows you the filter feeding speed of a peripheran, a sponge.
Larger particles. They might not look like they're doing much, but a simple demonstration shows how effectively sponges can pump water. On a reef in the Caribbean, I make a dive with a syringe filled with a non-toxic dye called fluorescein. By squirting it around the base of some sponges, we can observe how the water is moving by watching what the dye does. Within only seconds, the dye is pumped through the sponges along with the water. As you can see, a sponge is a pretty good water pump and also a good strainer. Any plankton that goes in with the water won't come back out through the osculum. Tube sponges are
the phylum of cnidarians. Cnidarians are defined by their stinging cells called cnidoblasts or cnidocytes. These cells have a harpoon-like structure that shoots out and can release venom, which can paralyze or kill its prey. They have a single opening for their mouth and their anus. They have radial symmetry, so again, that symmetry about a single point. And their diet usually consists of large zooplankton and even small fish. The individual units, the zooids, can either take the form of a polyp or a medusa. Polyps look like what you might think of as the anemone form, and then this medusa form is like with a bell shape and some tentacles at the bottom. So I'll go through each class of cnidarians and I'll show you some of the common animals in each group. So first, we'll start with the class of anthozoans, which includes sea anemones and corals. Sea anemones are predatory, and they completely lack that medusa stage, the one that looks like a jelly. So they're always in their polyp form. Some sea anemones, like these giant green anemones from Northern California, can form symbiotic relationships with photosynthetic algae. So they're actually performing photosynthesis. And then corals typically live in large colonies of identical polyps, each one looking a lot like sea anemones. You can see here a coral up close. The first coral shown here up at the top right is a photosynthetic soft coral, which is called the pulse coral because it moves its polyps in a pulsating motion to push water away from the colony and increase water flow. Tropical reef-building corals usually have a symbiotic dinoflagellates. So those are the single-celled protists that I think you've already heard about. And those are called zooxanthellae. Because these tropical corals depend on those zooxanthellae, they have to be in places where they get a lot of sun, such as in shallow, low nutrient water. Corals that don't have that dependency on photosynthetic symbionts can grow in other areas, such as the deep sea. So again, you may think of sea anemones as not that interesting because they typically don't move a lot. But this sea anemone has evolved to have a very unique after sensing that the leather stars
if you can see in the chat, but people had a little, it was a little hard to hear you over the music, but so I don't know if you want to reiterate any of the things you just said.
Yeah, so basically what I don't really know how to control the volume on that. So basically what the sea anemone is doing is it's contracting longitudinal muscles on either side of its body. So it'll contract one side while releasing the other side and then switch off. And it's basically able to swim away using those really simple muscles. So moving on, let's look at the medusozoans, the jellies. So this is the class of true jellies or scyphozoans. Here we can see that the medusa jelly-like phase is dominant and the polyp stage can sometimes be absent completely. In hydroids, the dominant phase can either be a polyp or a medusa, and most of them will alternate between the two throughout their life. A popular example of a hydroid is the Portuguese man of war. This isn't in the medusa form. Instead, it's a collection of many polyps that have very specialized functions. So some of the polyps are for stinging and catching food. Others are for reproduction. And then the big air bladder at the top is one big modified polyp called a pneumatophore. Then the cubozoans are box jellies. They're named because they have four tentacles and they look box-like from above. Their sting can be super dangerous to humans. And then these are my personal favorite. They're called starozoans. They're stalked jellyfish and they only exist in attached medusa. Their tentacles project upward and catch floating particles. So this is a video of a jelly giving birth. Let me see if I can get it to play. I'm wondering if this has music too. Can probably. So the polyp stage grows into what looks like a stack of bowls, which are each called an ephyra, which is the precursor to a medusa. And then the ephyra will pulse until they're finally separated from the stack of jellies. They turn upside down and then they float away and grow into a jelly. And this structure is called a strobilating scyphistoma. So the next phylum that we'll talk about is the phylum of mollusks. Mollusks are incredibly diverse and they are the largest marine phylum. They comprise about 23% of all marine organisms and they all share a couple features. So they all share a fleshy mantle, a muscular foot, a more developed nervous system, and they have a beak-like rasping radula. So basically a hard beak-like feature. And we'll talk about a couple of classes, but there's a lot more that we won't be able to cover. So first, the class of bivalves. Bivalves are a large group of mollusks that have laterally compressed bodies, which are enclosed by a shell with two hinged parts. Bivalves don't have a head or radula like the other two classes. You're probably familiar with clams, but here are some more unusual specimens. This one on the left is called the giant clam. As you can see here, they're very big. And they can weigh over 400 pounds. This one was about a meter across in Australia. The colorful mantle of the clam actually houses algal symbionts, just like we talked about earlier, which performs photosynthesis for the animal. And then other bivalves include scallops, which have thousands of really tiny eyes all along their mantle. And then oysters and mussels are also part of this class. So this is an organism called the disco clam, which was studied in Berkeley by Lindsay Doherty, a graduate student.
Everyone's favorite little bundle of joy, the disco clam, is known for having a good time. They can be found lounging on the ocean floor, partaking in these wonderful light shows. If you're wondering how they do this, it was recently discovered the inside of their lips are packed with tiny spheres of silica, which effectively reflect the ambient light. In contrast, the outside is not. So when the animal furls its lips in a wave-like motion, it produces this flashing effect, kind of like a disco ball. Before researcher Lindsay Doherty had a chance to examine this phenomenon in the lab, it was always assumed the lighting was just a product of bioluminescence. Now the answer she wants to know is why they do this. One idea suggests the light could act as a lure to attract prey, or as a warning to ward off predators, both common themes found throughout the animal kingdom. But what struck me as pretty cool is maybe it acts as a cue to encourage other clams to settle in the area. You see, as youngsters, disco clams take the form of these little free-swimming larvae known as villagers. In this state, they are much more mobile, allowing the species to disperse over greater distances. So this bright flashing light may be a guiding beacon telling the villagers, hey, it's safe to come over here. Look at me, I'm doing all right. But like all things in life, this need a bit.
Okay, so then the next class that we'll talk about are the gastropods. That includes snails and slugs. Shelled marine gastropods include cone snails, conches, abalone, periwinkles, whelks, and limpets. And another group, the sea slugs, have completely lost their shell. So this sea here is called Aplysia californica, and they can grow to be over 2 feet long. They're really common in Southern California. They can be found in shallow, warm tide pools. They're super soft and squishy, and I encourage you to go out and feel them. But make sure that you don't squeeze them too hard because they will excrete a purple ink. So everyone will know if you've mistreated your slug. Another type of sea slug are the nudibranchs. They're also soft-bodied, shell-less mollusks. They're really popular for their intense colors and their really diverse forms. At their front end, they have sensing organs, eyes, oral tentacles, and rhinophores. And then at their back end, they have these exposed gills. They're named for those naked gills, nudi meaning naked and branch meaning gill. This blue dragon nudibranch up here can do this thing called kleptonidae, where they eat the stinging cells off of a cnidarian and they use those stinging cells to protect themselves. This particular one steals the stinging cells of the deadly Portuguese man-of-war that we just talked about. So you may think that these kinds of colorful species could only exist in tropical waters, but we have tons of really colorful nudibranchs right here in California. So these are all photos I've taken of nudibranchs from Monterey, Santa Cruz, Laguna Beach, and Palos Verdes. So you can see they're super colorful and they have very different forms. This new to brink, Dendronotus iris, right here, is carnivorous and has some really cool behaviors, which I'll show you. So first, if you bother this nudibranch, it has a super just like the anemone, allows it to escape. And then when the nudibranch isn't running away from trouble, it goes looking for it. So this is a video that was filmed by my friend Joe Platko during an underwater photography competition. So it's a nudibranch climbing on a tube anemone, one of its favorite snacks. So it rears up its head in preparation for the yummy snack and it gets sucked in. So this nudibranch will be just fine. It just may take a while to extract itself. And once it does, it'll nibble on the tips of the anemone while keeping the anemone alive. And then it will go to lay some eggs on the anemone so that those babies will have some snacks to wake up to once they hatch. Here are two nudibranchs in a loving embrace. So most gastropods are hermaphrodites, so they possess the ability to create both male and female gametes. There are barriers in place so that they don't accidentally impregnate themselves, but when they encounter another slug, they can fertilize each other's eggs. So both will become pregnant and that they can each lay up to millions of eggs. Here's a close-up of what the 69 process looks like with each slug injecting his or her sperm into the other. Since no nudibranchs live up to be more than a year old, they get busy early and often, and occasionally they'll all get together to expedite the process. So this is a sea slug orgy. Because these slugs are hiding in the inside of the kelp, I couldn't photograph them all, but there were up to 100 in a single kelp patty. They're all cuddled together and kissing their reproductive openings together. So the next group of mollusks are the cephalopods. They have a very defined head region and are named for it. They have arms and or tentacles that have been modified from the muscular foot of mollusks. So technically, if you'd like to impress your friends at a cocktail party, there is a distinction between an arm and a tentacle, where an arm is an appendage with suckers that run all the way down the length of the arm, but a tentacle only has suckers at the end of the appendage. Cephalopods and gastropods have a radula, which is a sharp beak-like structure that allows them to bite and drill into their prey. When I was at Berkeley, the study I did on octopuses was looking at this drilling behavior. So basically every time the octopus will handle a snail, it will locate the area that has the thinnest shell and then drill a hole there. And you can see it's pretty much the exact same location on each snail it handles. When mating, the male octopus will stick its third right reproductive arm into the female's funnel, which is basically her nose, and injects a packet of sperm. It's very romantic. This is a photo of that process, and you can go there to see the video that I took. So squid are cephalopods with 8 arms and 2 tentacles, and they're very strong swimmers. They can jump out of the water and even fly for short distances. My friend took this photo on a cruise at sea, and at first they thought there were flying fish all around them. It wasn't until he uploaded the photo and looked really closely that they saw that they're actually squid. This hasn't, photographic evidence of this behavior was really just discovered quite recently. As you may know, octopuses are among the most intelligent invertebrates, as they have 4 pairs, and they have 4 pairs of arms. They have 3 hearts, and they can fit through pretty much any hole as long as it's large enough for their head. Also, in case you're curious and want to impress your friends again, the plural of octopus is in fact octopodes or octopuses, but saying octopi is technically incorrect, since the origin of the word is Greek and not Latin. Cuttlefish have 8 arms and 2 tentacles, just like the squid, but they have teeth on their suckers. They can be up to 20 inches long. Next, we have nautiluses, which are pelagic. So they swim in the open ocean, not just near the bottom. They have chambers of gas, which they can adjust to go up and down in the water column. And then the vampire squid is a small deep sea cephalopod, isn't very well studied, although one was kept alive for a while by the Monterey Bay Aquarium recently. This is a video showing some of the mimic abilities of an octopus.
The mimic octopus. It's a masterly quick change artist, altering not just its shape, but even its behavior to impersonate a whole range of other creatures. If danger threatens, a menacing color change is no problem. Time to move on. So it alters its shape to imitate a flounder, flattening its body and matching the color of the sand. It undulates low across the bottom, just like a real flounder. Most octopuses are very vulnerable in open water. Usually they hide amongst rocks or corals, and if they have to flee, they dart away behind a cloud of ink. But this mimic has another trick up its sleeve. It alters both shape and behavior to impersonate a fish that swims well above the bottom, a lionfish. Lionfish fins are tipped with venom, so predators learn to avoid them. By its deceit, the octopus shares that protection. Back on the sand, and it's being pestered by an aggressive damselfish. So it imitates something else. A sea snake. Sea snakes are amongst the most poisonous animals on Earth. They use their venom to immobilize their prey. Small fishes, like damselfish. If all else fails, the mimic octopus can always retreat down its hole.
Okay, moving on. The next phylum that we'll talk about is the phylum of annelids. So they are segmented worms, and there are 3 main groups, one of which is marine and 2 of which are terrestrial. The marine worms are called polychaetes. Some polychaetes live in tubes at hydrothermal vents, like these ones, while others, like the bristle worm, will typically crawl along the ocean floor. The terrestrial annelids include earthworms and leeches. This animal, the bobbit worm, can grow up to be 10 feet long and is a very voracious predator. This video really impresses people, if it works. So you can see the wide open jaws of the bobbit worm just waiting. So first try. Pretty impressive, very strong. And then let's see how it matches up with the octopus. And of course, octopus always wins. They're very cool. All right. Next, we'll talk about the phylum of arthropods. Arthropods have jointed appendages. Their name literally means jointed leg. They have segmented bodies, and they possess a hard exoskeleton, which they periodically get rid of in a process called molting or ecdysis. They're very diverse. There are over a million species of arthropods, and there are three main groups of arthropods, the crustaceans, chelicerates, and the hexapods. Crustaceans include decapods, which are common animals like lobster, crab, shrimp, stomatopods, which are the famous mantis shrimp that has incredible smashing force and crazy eyes that can distinguish the polarizing direction of incoming light. Maxillipods include the order Calanoida, which are the copepods. And then there are also some very wild parasitic copepods that look nothing like this, that have very modified forms. And then barnacles up here are also arthropods, even though on the surface they might look more like a limpet or mussel than a crab. But their jointed body is basically hiding in their hard little houses made of calcium carbonate. Their limbs are highly modified and highly reduced to live in these small fixed holes on the surface of rocks and whales. And then krill, a main food source for some of the largest creatures on Earth, are also crustaceans. So you may already be familiar with the mantis shrimp and its smashing strength. But I will try to show this video. Let's see. So they can...
It's the fastest punch in the animal kingdom and travels at about 23 meters per second and clocks forces of about 8,000 G. That's fast enough to rip water apart and create a little vacuum known as a cavitation bubble. And as that implodes, it generates extreme power and heat and even light. A woman called Professor Sheila Patek did this great article really investigating how it works. And there's a very interesting latch and saddle mechanism.
You can check out the link in the description below to see more of that. But we would have seen, I think, some quite spectacular things. But I'm really happy with how it came out.
Yeah, I think we've done well.
Well, that was pretty...
So anyway, they have an incredible smashing force, and they can also spear. The other ones have a spear that they can attack their prey with.
So, but we do like a challenge, so keep your suggestions.
But I thought that this was kind of a funny juxtaposition. So do you guys remember the disco clam that we talked about earlier? Get the video to work. So when we brought up the clams, you might have thought that they were not as cool as something that could smash and spear like the mantis shrimp. But this is a mantis shrimp trying to eat a disco clam and getting very flustered. So it tries to smash, and it doesn't work. And then the substance on the tentacles of the disco clam seemed to throw the mantis shrimp into this sort of strange catatonic state. And then eventually the mantis shrimp becomes so impressed with the disco clam that it tries to mate with it. So that was from the Caldwell Lab in Berkeley. In terms of other arthropods, There are chelicerates, which include spiders and horseshoe crabs. And the insects, which are hugely diverse, but mostly terrestrial, so we're just going to skip them for now. The next phylum I will talk about is the phylum of Echinodermata. So now we're going over to the deuterostomes. And echinoderms are typically characterized by their pentaradial symmetry, which means that they're they have a five-part symmetry. But these animals are still first and foremost bilaterians. So each animal's left and right sides are still symmetrical. There's some exceptions to the pentaradial symmetry in echinoderms. Like you can find sea stars with six legs or other examples like that. But again, they're always bilaterally symmetrical. They also have a hydrostatic skeleton, which helps them move away from predators. It helps them move their many tiny tube feet by pumping water through their bodies. There are five main classes of echinoderms, which include the sea urchins. Sea urchins and sand dollars are both in the group Echinoidea. They feed primarily on algae, and they can easily take out huge kelp forests if their populations are not kept in check by their main predators, the sea otter. Sea cucumbers are kind of like the vacuum cleaners of the sea. They eat sand and excrete clean sand. You may be familiar with the California sea cucumber, which looks a bit more like this, like a sea slug. But there are a lot of different types of sea cucumbers, including deep sea sea cucumbers that can swim and even walk around. This is called a sea pig. And then this is a deep sea sea cucumber that can swim. Brittle stars are similar to sea stars or starfish, but they have very fragile arms. They can easily drop an arm and regenerate that arm. So for the Echinodermata, if you lose a limb, they can also generate portions of their central disc along with the arms, so they can regenerate their body as well. You're probably more familiar with sea stars. Some sunflower stars can grow to be over 3 feet in diameter. And then finally, there are the crinoids. There are tropical crinoids that have short stalks and are found in shallow water. And then there's another variety, which are found in deep water with longer stalks. Bethany, I'll ask for your help with this. Does anybody know what this animal is?
Put it in the chat.
Any guesses?
Will the dice be wrong?
Sorry?
Someone says, is it a brittle star? Catherine Walton said, is it a brittle star? We have a guess from a GSI. Is it a sponge?
Yeah, it is actually a basket star from Bremer Bay in Australia. So it's a relative of sea stars, urchins, and sea cucumbers. And it's all closed up right now, but at night it will let its arms out to frisk the current for any passing nibbles. So it's a suspension feeder as well. What about this? Any guesses?
Is it a stonefish?
This is actually called a frogfish. So this is a Commerson's frogfish from the Philippines. It is a fish, which is a vertebrate, and it's going to introduce us to the phylum of chordates. So essentially, chordates just have a more developed nervous system and more axial support in the form of a notochord, which appears at some point in development. And they also have to possess these other three traits at one point in their life. So a dorsal hollow nerve cord, pharyngeal gill slits, and a postanal tail. Besides these four defining characteristics, it can be pretty challenging to see the similarities between these three groups of chordates. So between the subphylum that we're in, and then these ones. So tunicates are gelatinous creatures that can either be sessile, attached to the substrate, or pelagic, which means that they live in open water. Some pelagic tunicates can grow to be very large. This sea turtle is eating a colonial tunicate right here. And a related group are the appendicularians, or larvations, which are very small creatures that secrete a large mucus net that catches food through the moving water. When enough of the food attaches to the mucus net, they will eat their mucus house. And this process is really important to the global carbon cycle because their mucus houses collect dense calcium carbonate material, which allows that material to sink to the deep ocean where it's sequestered. Going back to the larger group of chordates, we turn to the subphylum Cephalochordata, or the lancelets. These are slender creatures which have a notochord throughout their life. And we actually think that these are our closest relatives among all the invertebrates. Here's a short video that just shows the size of these pelagic tunicates. Get it to play. One more time. So essentially the water goes into the music's going on. The water goes into thousands of individual salps, and then those pump the water through to propel the pyrosome forward. This is just such a large collection of salps. All right, and then finally, we get to our own subphylum, the vertebrates. So this includes any animal with a backbone. The marine animals in this phyla include fish, marine mammals, some marine reptiles, and birds such as penguins. And I will end on that. So I would like to get the chat up so I can see what's going on. Every time I click on it, it just goes away. But I guess, Bethany, you can let me know if there are questions. I think I might just hop into the little poll. So I have a little quiz for you now to guess what phylum this animal is in.
Put your answers in the chat, and then I'll relay your questions after we do these few poll questions. Any guesses in the phylum? Seeing a C, a B, an A. A few C's in there, got a D. Mostly A's is what I'm seeing.
Okay, well, yeah, A is correct. This is an elbow crab. It's in the phylum Arthropoda. What about this one?
Seeing C's and D's.
C's and D's.
Well, more C's now.
The C's have it. It is a sea anemone, which is in the phylum of cnidarians. What about this one?
Getting E's. Bunch of E's.
Yeah. So yeah, this is a crown of thorn sea star. It's an invasive species in Morea. That really plagues their coral. What about this one? This one's tricky.
Bunch of D's, a few E's.
Yeah, so this is actually a sea cucumber. These are the feeding tentacles on the top of a sea cucumber that is local to Monterey. These are the branched feeding tentacles of a sea cucumber, which is in the group of echinoderms. What about this one?
Some bees.
Some bees? Yeah, this is a fish. So it's a white margin stargazer from the Philippines. Super creepy looking fish.
Someone asked, is it still alive?
It is still alive. So it has this crazy body, like its mouth and its eyes are located on the top of its body. And then it just has like this large body with pretty much nothing on it. So everything happens up at the front top end. What about this one?
A lot of D's.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a mollusk. So this is a giant keyhole limpet. They're super big. They're like this big. And then what about this? Let's start with the first one.
The E's have it.
Yes, they do. Yes, this is a bat star. And then what about the second one?
A lot of D's in the chat and a few C's.
Yeah, so that's a squid, which is in the group of mollusks. What about this one? I think this is a video. I'll play it.
Everyone's saying C.
And so this one always tricks people. This is actually a barnacle. So it's an arthropod. These are the feeding appendages of a giant acorn barnacle, which is an arthropod. All right, so I'm asking what this is in the foreground here, not the shrimp. I think you could probably get the shrimp right.
Everyone's saying C.
C? So no, this is actually the little structures that are on top of a velvet sea star. So it's an echinoderm.
Trick.
Yeah, very tricky. So I've just attached some useful terminology, and then I also forwarded a worksheet that you guys can fill out and hopefully help you study. I think that at least the way that's been done in previous years is that you're basically just responsible for being able to identify what type of animal is associated with what phylum. You probably won't get something as tricky as the zoomed in things on the top of a sea star.
Thank you so much, Jesse. Some of the questions that we had in the chat, some people were curious about the intelligence and particularly emotion of octopi or octocipides rather, sorry. And other cephalopods, considering that they have very developed nervous systems.
Yeah, so one of the projects that I helped out with when I was at Berkeley was looking at the fear response of octopuses. So the experiment sort of sedated the octopus so it couldn't feel anything and removed part of its brain that was responsible for fear. And after that was removed, it didn't have the ability to autotomize an arm. So normally if an octopus's arm gets damaged, it will just drop the arm and then the rest of its body will be fine. So that would suggest that it definitely has the ability to feel pain or at least respond to it. And I think that the topic of intelligence is really fascinating because I don't necessarily agree with all the ways that humans choose to define intelligence. I think that in a lot of senses, animals are very well adapted to survival. And like, for example, I work with elephant seals who may not be considered the most intelligent marine mammals, but at the same time, they're able to find their way to a feeding location somewhere in the middle of the North Pacific, halfway to Japan, and find their way back and navigate perfectly. What is intelligence really? I think octopuses have the ability to escape. They have the ability to do a lot of things that impress humans. But I just have an issue with the way that intelligence is defined sometimes. But I would say that they're intelligent.
We had another question in the chat about the sea star that you showed us, or the basket. Star and being nocturnal. And so are these like more shallow water species where they're getting light, or do they have some diurnal cycling to be able to know when it's night, even in the dark ocean?
So I think that I'm not an expert in basket stars. That one that I found was not super deep, and it was the only one I've ever seen. And then I've also seen some get picked up by trawlers. So those definitely live in the deep ocean. So I don't know, but I think that some are shallow water species and some are deeper water species.
We have some questions about marine animals in tropical areas, whether it stands that they're typically more colorful. I know you showed us some examples from Northern California, the waters of Northern California, where even though we're subtropical, or that they were quite colorful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think that Jim usually talks a little bit in the class about water and its absorption properties and how light transmits through water. So I think that that definitely has an impact on how colorful things get. But I'm always just shocked at the bright colors that you see in Monterey at the, you know, at 70, 90, 100 feet, you can shine a flashlight and see these bright reds that are, you know, I will have my strobes not working for one photo and working for the other photo, and it will look like something's just pitch black, and then I'll have my strobes working and it'll be a bright red. So, I mean, I think the question is more, what are animals perceiving? And that is hugely variable across animals, right? So some animals have the ability to see color, some are more attuned to see value, like white and dark. So yeah, it's an interesting question, and I think that there's tons of really colorful stuff, really deep, where it's probably not being fully appreciated by every animal that swims by.
See if we have any other questions. So we have a question from Catherine about the devices that you built for monitoring seals. Could those be adapted to other animals, or are they specialized specifically for the seals that you study?
So I'd say they're probably more designed for like a seal or a dog or something that has that general morphology in terms of its skull and body. But in essence, I mean, those are the same techniques that are used in birds, for example, to measure sleep in birds. And sloths, I think it's probably electrophysiological sleep is usually only measured in mammals. We haven't really tried to measure it in animals like fish or sharks, but I think it would be interesting.
Thank you so much. I don't see any other questions in the chat. Thank you. That was wonderful, as always. And the slides have been posted to B courses for people who are interested. And there are many, many thank yous in the chat from all the people in the course.
Thank you.